Okay, good morning, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon. Salaam alaikum. First of all, I would like to express my sincere greetings to all Muslim friends for a happy Ramadan. Ramadan Mubarak ho. So today we are going to present on quality management systems and APAC things. So please mute your microphone, everybody. As our previous, will and put your questions to the message, then we will respond at the end. Is it okay? Anisi, slides is coming?
Yeah, it's coming.
Okay, good.
Coming.
Please mute microphone, okay, everybody, please. Okay, good morning. Today I'm going to talk about quality management system through APAC accreditation and certification of TVET Institute. This is a very important topic for all of us because in today's all TVET Institute has to manage their quality. That's why this QMS quality management system is very vital. So introductions of my presentations about the introduction. First, I'm going to talk about the QMS. QMS consists three important words: quality, management, and system. So quality, always when we are talking about qualities, we have to think about time, scope of the work, and cost. How much money we spend for that, how many resources we use that. So in the name of quality, if we spend more cost and more time and it takes longer, it cannot be considered as efficient quality management system. That's why these three O's is very important. And always quality management systems always comes with plan. You have to do any sort of plan. Then procedures, what are the procedures to execute that plan and its standards. When we talk about quality management system, there should be a standard. In what standard we want to achieve? For examples, if our institute is considering, okay, APAC standard, means APAC international standard, means that is a kind of standards we have to do. So these three words is also very important: plan, procedures, and standards. If there is no these three or three things, planning, procedures, and standard things, we cannot consider as QMS, okay? So I'm going to explain now these three words: quality management system. First, quality. Quality is the accuracy of result to the target. Like during our plan, for example, our strategic plan, for 5 years strategic plan, if we fix, we will train 5,000 youths and ensure 80% employment of them. Out of 5,000, there will be 2,000 diploma graduates and 3,000 vocational skills training graduates short term. Still, I am hearing sound. Please, somebody is not muting mic. And children sound. Children is crying. Please mute your mic. And that's why when we talk about quality, always accuracy of result to the target. That is very important. Second one is degree of satisfaction of customers on our product, service, or a system. Means if we are producing, our product is graduates, right? If we are producing TVET graduates, our customers means the graduates itself, their parents and industry, employer. If they are happy with our graduates, means that is a kind of quality indicator. This is the second important things we have to consider. And third important thing is quality is determined by context or situation. I already mentioned about quality is determining by context or situation. We discussed last time also. There is a sound, please, a person has to mute, please. Quality is determining by context or situation. That's why, when we are talking about quality, we cannot copy paste the plan, procedures, and standard from one country to another country. Context is different. Situation is different. That is very important. And another important thing is...
I know. Yes, sir.
Hello, sir. From Bangladesh, please mute your mic. Otherwise, leave the things. Okay. Proxy quality indicator for Tibet is proxy or quality indicator for Tibet. Is,
Mr.
Can we see Ghaniji, who is in the
mic? Yes, sir. Carry on, sir.
Argel, could you please register out that person from the system?
Okay, sir.
If they don't mute, okay. Okay, proxy quality indicator for Tibet is gainful employment of graduates. If we are talking quality like target, customer satisfactions, and quality is determined context, but ultimate proxy indicator of quality is gainful employment of our graduates. That's why if we are talking what is the quality of Tibet systems, we have to consider these four important elements. That is a quality. According to Aristotle, I already mentioned this, quality is not an act, it is a habit. So we have to develop, we have to establish culture, we have to establish system to produce the quality graduates. That's why we are talking quality management things. So we have to develop habit, not we cannot say the 2020s graduates got 100% got employment means that is for that year, but what is the employment rate of previous years? And what is our, you know, efforts? So system should be there. We have to create habit or culture for the quality management. So another important topic is what is like an element is management. So all of you are very good managers. So I'm not going to tell a lot about this. Management is an art of getting things done through others. So as a principal or director, if we able to manage our people to achieve the goal, that is the, you know, management, effective management. So for the management, always, you know, the competency to operate system of input, process, output, that is a general system, with the appropriate mix of six M's. If a person, if a manager or leader of the institute, they mix appropriately six M's, that is called effective and efficient management. That is men or women. Second M is money. Third M is machines. Fourth M is materials. Fifth is methods. And sixth is markets. Okay. Markets means our industry, our head office, the labor market, students, whole market, our Tibet market, global market. So management properly, these six M's is considered as a good management. Another is systems. Everybody know what is the education system. I already showed this last time, like national education policy, national qualification framework, national education strategic plan. Then input, these are the inputs, curriculum, textbook, teaching material, human resource, other resources. Then processes like a teaching pedagogy or andragogy, evaluations and certifications, how is the process, how is the system there. And third one is like output for Tibet Institute, output is graduates. Then outcomes is the employment of our graduates. Like I already mentioned, if our strategic plans define their, you know, our targeted employment rate is 80%. So did we get that or not? Then living standard of our graduates' family. Then social harmony and GDP. These are the outcomes of Tibet system, education system. And ultimately, the whole things we have to do proper monitoring and evaluation things. That's why this is called general education system. So quality management systems means these three words, if we handle, if we manage properly, that is called quality management system. So if you remember the total quality management things, everybody are aware of this, there is a five pillars of the total quality management. One is product, Second one is process. Third one is organizations. Fourth one is leadership. And fifth one is commitment. That's why if we are talking about quality management system in our organizations, in our TVET Institute, we cannot forget these five pillars. That is very important. Each pillar has equally important. If the one pillar collapse, remaining four pillars will collapse. That's why these five pillars we have to manage properly. Ecosystems, I already discussed this also, like 3 P's plus 4 C's. Program, people, process, this is called 3 P's, and 4 C's are ultimately in the center of the heart, you know, like a institute, core of the heart, customer. Because in quality, customer satisfaction is the prime indicator. That's why if we have to, you know, satisfy our customers, these 3 P's has to manage very well, then following the culture, communication, and commitment. Like that, you know, the five pillars of the TQM. This is called 3 P's plus 4 C's are the ecosystem of quality management system. So now I'm going to show one video. Please watch this about the what is QMS.
Quality management system. What is it? Why have one? First of all, what is a quality management system or QMS? Quality management system is a structured collection of policies, procedures, processes, and their associated responsibilities. These policies, procedures, and processes are integrated so that, working harmoniously as a single system, they make it easier for the staff and personnel of a business or service organization to achieve its quality vision, mission, goals, and objectives. Of course, these policies and procedures need to be documented, but that does not have to consist of paper documents, unless that is the organization's preference. More likely, they will be stored and maintained in an electronic format on the organization intranet or cloud storage, and might just consist of HTML web pages. So, what are the advantages of having a quality management system? Why would an organization want a QMS? I like to summarize the benefits under three headings: simplify, clarify, and control. Firstly, simplify. Do you have site visits from prospective customers? Having a QMS enables sale site visits to be a structured and constructive conversation, where prospects actually expect you to show restraint, the restraint required for obtaining comprehensive voice of customer, finding out exactly what is required instead of contracting to wild promises based on the fuzziness of getting a sale at all costs. In addition, such customer visits become opportunities for you to review your processes for improvement and help you become more competitive. Having a QMS helps enormously to improve the communication within your organization, whether that be cross-functional, cross-departmental, or cross-location. A QMS helps you to take a structured approach to correcting mistakes or defects. Corrective actions and preventive actions, also known as CAPA, are consistently undertaken based on a priority and diligence driven by risk, which places first things first. QMS-based CAPA process also ensures that higher risk problems and issues are promptly, properly dealt with and do not return. Risk, of course, can and should be considered both from a safety and a business point of view. See improved customer or client satisfaction from a more formalized and thorough QMS-driven complaint handling system, that always closes the loop with the customer. See, fewer defects, rework or scrap at the various points of quality control because of an improved QMS-based design process. See, improved design because of better voice of customer input to requirements and specifications. Secondly, clarify. First and foremost, a quality management system will clarify roles and responsibilities. Everyone knows what their area of responsibility is, what is expected of them, who their internal or external suppliers and customers are, and who is responsible for what. The QMS will help everyone in your company or organization understand what your internal operational processes are and how they link from your suppliers through your manufacturing or service operations to your customers or clients. Employees all understand where their contribution fits into the big picture. The QMS will drive consistency in staff training, as well as continuous improvement in staff training. All the above lead to improved staff morale, happier customers, with miscommunication identified and rectified early. Thirdly and finally, control. QMS gives form and substance to your organization's commitment to a vision and mission, linking what you aim to achieve with the who and the how of your internal operational processes. A well-implemented QMS enables you to control your processes for greater effectiveness and efficiency, enabling your staff to feel pride in their work and demonstrate their value. QMS-driven performance of internal processes drives greater consistency in output and final product, whether manufacturing or service. This, in turn, drives the identification of opportunities for improvement. As required by a QMS, measurable, continuous improvement in quality and productivity will become part of the organization culture, the way we do things. A well-implemented and sensible QMS will ensure regular measurement, trending, and reporting to executive management of critical indicators or key performance indicators known as KPIs. These provide a view of current operational performance as well as a heads up on areas of concern which warrant further investigation. The above controls will result in improved customer satisfaction from the delivery of better quality products with the early detection of fewer faults and defects, all before final delivery. Well-implemented and sensible QMS will lead to less waste of time and materials, cutting costs and improving profitability.
Okay, so the quality management systems concept, I hope it's a little bit, you know. So now I'm going to talk about some regional issues in technical education and vocational training. These are, you know, the common issues we are facing. Like TVET system is not fully geared to means market-based TVET program. So we are not providing market-based TVET programs. Still, there is a huge gap between demand and supply. So industry are seeking competent workers, And we, Tibet institutions, are claiming we are producing very good workers, or let's say graduates, but industry are not getting competent workers and our graduates are not getting job. See, means there is a mismatch. Another is competencies and qualification of teacher instructor is varies. Like if we talk about the Asia Pacific region, different countries has different competencies, you know, standards. So there is a variation. And some countries are, you know, making mandatory of the at least 2 years to 3 years industry experience to be a Tibet teacher. Of many countries doesn't have that criteria. So there are variations. Third important issues is like standardization of Tibet courses. Insufficient standardizations. So that course with the same titles have different contents. Like some countries, if you talk about Tibet, even for 3 months course, some country issue diploma in plumbing, diploma in electricians. But diploma means in general, we consider like 3 years, 4 years course. That's why there is a variation in the standardization also. And fourth important issue is we are facing like coordination between training institute and industry. Still there is a lack of, you know, linkages and coordinations, or let's say like, you know, the weak partnership between industry and institute, which is the industry partnership is the vibrant things to maintain quality management system of the Tibet to produce quality graduates. But our graduates are unable to see the even door of the industry, means what type of, you know, graduates we are producing. That is a major issue. Then fifth one is the integration of employability competencies that we are already discussed, like in employability competencies, or let's say soft skills part, entrepreneurship skills, communication skills, cognitive thinking, and technological, you know, like a digital thinking. These are the missing. So our curriculum should have a balance between KSA, knowledge, skills, and attitude. So these are the common regional issues we are facing today. And if we see the, you know, labor market, labor mobility trends and regional integrations, I already showed these slides many times. It's still, you know, in the globe, the entire globe, the yellow, you know, the circle countries, they are facing deficit of the, you know, working populations, and the green circles countries have surplus population, surplus workforce. That's why from green circle country to yellow circle country, there is obvious that everybody will go there for work. So we cannot stop. Considering this global phenomena, or let's say labor market situation, we have to consider globally competencies, skills, and standards and quality. That's why if the graduates from Bangladesh is going to work in Malaysia or let's say Italy, that employer of Italy or let's say Malaysia should know how is that institute, what is the quality standard of institute. So this is the, you know, global context why we need international accreditations, means for the recognitions of the quality and recognition of the quality management of system of that Tibet institution. So this is a kind of, you know, labor mobility trends and regional integration thing. So in some point we have to do regional integrations of the Tibet system. So now I am jumped to APAC, okay? The history of APAC means Asia Pacific Accreditation and Certification Commission. This is the full form of APAC. In 1973, the Colombo Plan Start College established, CPSC. That is in the 1973. And after, you know, almost 30 years, in 2004, CPSC signed sole declarations and to establish the APAC. That's why these are the three stages of APAC. In 2004, International Conference on Accreditation and Certification, that is called SOL, in December, that is called SOL Declaration 2004. Following years, in 2005, the regional workshop on regional accreditation modeling and accreditating the accreditators, Manila, that is called Manila. Then that conference, that workshop produced, brought Manila resolutions for OPAC. And in 2007, again in Korea, Chenon, Korea, that is called Chenon Affirmation of Commitment 2007. So formally in 2007, Asia Pacific Accreditation and Certification Commission established. So this is the new logo of the Asia Pacific and Certification Commission. So I will not explain about the meaning of logo. So you can read it. Blue gear with CPSC letter, upturned hands, green building on map, that is for sustainable development in the Asia Pacific region. So there is a meaning, okay? So quality assurance mechanism for TVET, a framework like OPAC, is an internationally recognized sign of quality. So there is a question, there might be many questions. Why do we need OPAC accreditations? So it is a similar to things, you know, why we have to wear very pleasant dress, or let's say very standard dress, or let's say official dress. Like why not to do maintain our personality? That is the same things. How our market or how our customers will perceive to us means if we have a recognition of quality from the external organizations or from the outsiders, renowned organizations, means that is a kind of marketing tools. That is a kind of image of the organizations. That's why OPAC is an internationally recognized sign of quality for the TVET Institute. This OPAC accreditations, basically OPAC accreditations is only for the institutional accreditations. We will not do TVET program accreditations. Like program accreditations will be done by the respective member countries, national body. But OPAC will just do the institutional accreditation. How is the quality management system of that TVET Institute? We will answer that questions. So characteristics, if we talk about the characteristics of OPAC, this is a voluntary. The OPAC is not a mandatory thing. So if the member government or TVET Institute wanted to do their accreditations, OPAC will be there. So both sides will do this. This is a kind of voluntary job, not a mandatory. And second is the OPAC accreditation is based on criteria. We have a 7 criteria. I will explain later. So the accreditation is based on criteria, not only the quality and descriptive part. And it is a partnership endeavor between OPAC and accrediting applied institutions. So it will be a partnership between Institute, OPAC, and even we can say tri-partnership, because the central authority, accreditation authority of the government, member country, would be there. So that organization was OPAC and TVET. So three parties will come together. That's why it is called partnership. And it is a openness and transparency. It is governed by openness and transparency. Our evaluation system, our assessment system is very transparent. So it is, nobody will hide what is happening, and we will give report very transparent. Similarly, this is a kind of value added dimension for the national government regulations. Like in every member country, there is a quality assurance system. Like every national government, there is a TVET authority, and within the TVET authority, as an independent organization, there is an accrediting body. So if we do international accreditations, and if we do this OPAC accreditations, it will value add to your national accreditations, and it will give a kind of value, a kind of certification to the international market about the quality management system. And this is another end of this characteristic. This is a continual improvement initiatives. So because of the OPAC accreditations, TVET institutional improvement will be very continue, you know, and this will be a kind of things because of driving things, because of this, institute management will focus for the quality. Means they feel, oh, APAC accreditation is happening in 2022. Means you will start to think from today to quality improvement. So this is a kind of driving force to the TVET institute management. That's why continual improvement will happen. And this is an external evaluation. So APAC accreditation means you will get two benefits. One is certificate of accreditations about the quality management. Second thing is you can put this certificate as an certificate of the external evaluation. Maybe some like private institute, if they want money, let's say from loan from bank, they can put, they can submit APAC accreditation certificate to the bank. Means they are maintaining quality management system within the institute. So this document will value add you. Even government institute, within the institute, there will be competitions. So if there are, let's say, 200 polytechnics or technical institute within the country, so between 200, there will be a kind of competition happen. So like you know, internal competition things. So that will also boost for quality. And accredited the TVET institutions, which I already mentioned, and recognized by the national or sub-regional level. So this body means APAC accreditations means at least in Asia Pacific region, it will be well recognized. So these are the characteristics of APAC. So benefits, why we have to do APAC accreditation? These are the benefits. As we already discussed, this is a sign of international recognition of quality. So if you have APAC accreditation, means you will get a international recognition of quality. That is a kind of, you know, quality ambassador. So APAC certificate is quality ambassador for your institute. You can promote things. Second is regional mobility of workforce and qualification. So we are, so like in, you know, ASEAN countries, now ASEAN countries finalizing the EQRF, like EQRF, ASEAN Qualification Referencing Framework. So we are discussing where can we fit this APAC accreditation certificate in that ASEAN Qualification Referencing Framework. Means there will be a mobility of workforce from one country to another. That time, even like a credit transfer things between institute, we can apply this as a tools. And quality improvement drive, I already mentioned, this is a very good, you know, tools for the quality improvement drive. And it will, you know, mobilize you to implement the quality management system in your institute. And the regional network of quality assured institution. There is a called AAA, Association of APAC Accredited Institute, that is called AAA. There is a regional network. And because of this regional network, now there is a, you know, mutual partnership between one institute to another institute, one country to another countries, and they have already started like teacher exchange programs. They have already started, you know, other exposures exchange program. This is a very good network. So APAC accreditations will support you to establish network within the Asia Pacific regions, TVET institute. And even we can share curricula. If we have a very good network, we can use, no need to make a separate curricula. We can take a reference from other country and we can just, you know, revise based on the context of the country. So no need to do whole lot. And quality assured and employment ready graduate. So, and another thing is, because of the quality management system in the TVET institute, it will assure the quality and will produce the employment ready graduates because of the quality management system. If you don't have quality management system and accreditations by international, so how can we ensure that we are producing quality graduates and we are producing, because this is a kind of certification thing we do. Like for example, if I'm very like a pleasant and I have a very good personality, but if other people will not say, oh, you are very, you have your personality is very good, or you are very smart, then who will know? That's why there should be a systems which somebody has to tell. That's why a pack will tell you, you are either you are doing quality management system in your institute or not. This is a kind of external evaluations I already discussed. And employer and public confidence. For example, now people doesn't have time. We have to hire people, you know, workforce quickly. For example, one industry need urgent workforce within a week, then they don't have a recruitment process, the time for recruitment process. At that time, if you have OPAC accreditations, means employer will get confidence that, oh, this TVET Institute is OPAC accredited institute. That's why I will recruit the graduates of that institute without taking any written and oral test for the employment. Means OPAC certificate is a kind of confidence which can enhance the confidence for the employer. So these are the basic benefits, but there are indirectly many benefits. Okay, so now you might have questions. We already talked, it is a criterion based. So what are the OPAC criteria? These are the 7 criteria. Governance and management. All 7 criterias, we have a total 500 points. Out of 500 points, governance and management consists 46. Teaching and learning consists 120. Human resource consists 74. Research and development, R&D, consists 50. Image and sustainability, 50. Other resources, 110. And support to student safety. So we evaluate, we assess the TVET institutions based on these 7 criteria. And there are variations of the marks because considering the importance of the criteria, like teaching and learning has high weightage, 120, because teaching and learning environment is the vital things. And teaching pedagogy, delivery part, the environment, whole thing is very vital. That's why we have put this like that. And awards, based on that criterion evaluations, we will award in different level. Like there are 5 awards. First one is bronze. Bronze, if the institute received 301 to 350 out of 500 points, they will get bronze award. And if the institute really got 351 to 400 points, that is considered as bronze plus award. If the institute got 401 to 450 points, that is silver award. And 451 to 490 is gold award, and of 491 to 500 is considered as platinum. That's why there are 5 level of awards, bronze to platinum. If the institute, you might have questions, what will happen if some institute got, let's say, 280? So below 300, if the institute received 300 and below, that institute will not consider as an institute which is maintaining minimum standard for quality management system. That's why we will not award them. So to be awarded from APAC, the institute must secure the points above 300. Okay, so this is the level of awards. And process, you might have many questions. So how to do this process? Process of accreditation and certification. So I'll not read all. So you will have a, handouts, PowerPoint presentations with you. So when after this presentation, you can read. Applicant institute, first process is like applicant institute will send application with NCA's endorsement. NCA's means national organizations, national authority. That is called NCA. National authority should endorse, means, for example, in your country, like we can say quality, let's say Malaysian qualification authority, or let's say Department of Technical Education is the national authority, means they consider as NCA. Okay, so NCA will have to endorse that application. If the Polytechnic A wants to apply to APAC, that application should come with the endorsement of the national authority of the accreditations or TVET. Okay, that depends upon the countries. And after that, application processing and review, when the APAC secretariat will receive applications, then we will review it. And if that application is eligible and with complete documents, we'll jump to another process. If yes, if no, then again we'll return that application to the NCA and the concerned institute with our feedback. So what are the missing part? Please submit this. And if you do not submit this set of documents and process, standards, procedures, means you will not be eligible for accreditation. That's why please submit again with the additional documents like this. We'll suggest that way. And if yes, then send self-study form. The APAC secretariat will send that institute called self-study form. There is a standard form you can find from our website. The website is there, www.apacforhrd.org, which is clearly mentioned in the right upper corner of this slide. That is our website. So you will get, the institute will get self-study report form. Then application institute will prepare and review the SSR. Self-study reports, they will review again. Application institute will send and APAC will review that. Then if yes, if the SSR complete and SSR score cutoff means above 300, then we will go for further steps. If not, again we'll send back to institute. Then self-study form will convert to SSR, means self-study report. Okay, like a institute has to do self-evaluate by yourself first, and you have to prepare that report, and that report has to submit to APAC. If that report, based on that report, if the score is above 300, we will go for another steps. Otherwise, again we will return to that to institute. So SSR means self-study report. An applicant institute, SUN and APAC, like both parties, if the SSR is okay, above than 300 cutoff point in the document base, then agreement on on-site visit schedule. Both parties will agree when will be the on-site visit. We'll fix the schedule. Then identification of team members. APAC will identify the team lead assessor, and members, there will be a three people in a team. So based on that fixed schedule, APAC secretariat will identify the expert team. And then prepare and send confirmation of on-site visit for APAC accreditation to institute. That is the another steps. And coordination with institutions and accreditations. Then B part, on-site visit. We'll do on-site visit. It will be 3 days. In general, 3 days on-site visit. Then APAC board, it will come to APAC board, the deliberations, and the APAC board will, there is a board of the Asia Pacific Accreditation and Certification Commission, where, you know, now currently I'm holding the president position. So this board will conduct the meeting, then the report of the on-site visit will discuss critically, and if yes, then APAC will accredit and certificate that, you know, organizations. Then if not, then board may think, but for that, always the institute can appeal to the board. If they will not satisfy with the, you know, system, result of bad things. Then review appeal, when the appeal will come, it will review. Then accredited institution, after the getting award and certificate, accredited institute has to submit again action plan and biannual report. Every 2 years they have to submit report and annual fee. The repeat cycle from preparation of updated SSR. So this is after 4 years. Please, somebody my, please.
Mr. Varel.
Please close him, okay? Bhargav. Okay, then appeal will review by board. Then if the appeal accepted, then corrective actions will be taken place and review and correction action. This is a process. There is a appeal provisions. So if some institute doesn't like the, you know, report or some complaint, they can do appeal. So this is a process. So you will get this in handout. So if you have any confusion, if you have further queries, let us know by email. We are always ready to respond to you. And so descriptive indicators of quality. When the out 3 persons team will visit the on-site, conduct the on-site visit, they will prepare report that descriptive indicators of quality. There will be a, in addition to, you know, score of the all 7 criteria, the report will consist 3 qualitative indicators. One is commendations. What is commendation? Means commendations means noteworthy practices that are over and above the OPAC requirements. Means we have a basic requirements like a national minimum equal requirements of the TVET institutions. If that institutions has achieved or they have implemented very innovatively or extraordinarily than other common in organizations, or if they are above than the minimum requirement, that things will be highlighted in the commendation part of each criteria. Commendation means above than minimum standards, or let's say innovations, creativity, are in extraordinary than other institute. So that is a thing. For example, in this context, like you know, digital technology things and some innovative work, this is considered as commendations. And second descriptive indicators is affirmations. Affirmation means acknowledgement of adequacy of program. Means if the institutions fulfill all the requirement, minimum requirement of OPAC or national, you know, minimum standard, means that point is highlighted in affirmations. Means you achieve what you wanted as per the requirement. But if you achieve above than your standard, means commendations. If you achieve similar to standard, that is affirmations. If you are below than standards, we will not say feedback, we will not say below standards, or you will not say this institution is not achieving with the minimum standard, but those points will write in recommendations, like suggested measures to address gaps in order to comply with OPAC requirements. If the institutions couldn't meet OPAC requirements, those gaps will be highlighted in this recommendations part. So these 3 elements, commendations, affirmations, recommendations, we will write in a report for each criteria. It will be in the, for all 7 criteria, you will get a report of commendations, affirmations, recommendations. Okay. So this is called descriptive indicator for quality. And there might be views questions. So what will be the fee for OFAC? We told this is a voluntary, but there is a fee. Fee means just to cover the cost. OPAC is not getting any benefit. OPAC will not charge any profit. We are just getting the fees. So I will not read all points. If you have a queries, you can ask. So application fee, that is a US$100 is application fee. And in Philippines case, it is 5,000 peso. And it has to be paid upon the applications. Accreditation fee, the second is accreditation fee. It is US$600. and for Philippines peso 30,000. So that is the in the time of, you know, accreditation time, you have to pay, institution has to pay an annual fee. If the organization pay lump sum of all 4 years, that is, you know, 300 per year, means for 4 years, annual fee is per year 300, but if they paid at a time, it will be 1200. But if the institution pay yearly, not at a time, it will be 350 per year. Okay, so that is the rate. And in addition to that, institution has to provide accommodation, food and transportation for the three exports. That's why if the institutions of one country, for example, Pakistan, if the 4 or 5 institute coordinate each other and they invite, they fix that accreditation time at schedule at a time, let's say 15 days slot, then the cost will be very less because the same airfare and things man can share by 4 institute. No need to go every time. The 4 institute can plan at a time, like a 3 into 4 means 12 days, means the 1 year fear can share by 4 institute. So it will be cheaper. So this is called, this is the fees. So if you have any queries, you can send questions, concerns. This is, I think, hope you will get detailed information from this slide. So status so far, what is the status of the, you know, APAC? So this is the status. Up to now, 12 countries, Tibet institutions have applied, 140 institute applied, out of 140, 59 institutions got accreditations. So this is the overall status. And so active and inactive, April 20. So as of April 20, if you see, you know, there is a from Bangladesh, like a bronze award institute 4, India 1 gold, 2 silver, 1 bronze, Malaysia 13 gold, out of 13, all are gold in Malaysia. Very good. Mongolia 1 gold, 2 silver, 1 bronze, 4. Pakistan 1 bronze. Philippines 5 gold, 5 silver, 1 bronze and 16 bronze plus and 16 bronze, 27. And Thailand 6 gold, out of 6 gold. And out of 6, there are like a 2 from private institute, 3 from private institute and 3 from public institute. So, and this year about 10 institute is coming for accreditation from Thailand, and many from Philippines and Malaysia also. So this is the kind of summary information for you. And this is a very interesting figure. And this is a research. We figured out this diagram from our report. You know, this APAC accredited institute performance, if you see the per criteria, now the institutions are weak in research and development. The criteria number 4. In an average, only 67.7% they have achieved. So most of the Tibet institutions are lacking quality management things in research and development. And after that, image and sustainability. But rest of the others are above 80. So governance and management 87.2. Teaching and learning 86.8. Human resource 88.9, and other resources 87.2, support to student 83.1. This is as of April 2020, April 30, you know, this month. So this is a kind of research findings from the report. So still Tibet Institute has to focus more on research and development, because why research and development is important? If we are conducting competency-based, market-based program, all the programs should be based on research, based on demand. And are we conducting tertiary study of our graduates? Are we conducting labor market study? Are we conducting research for the curricula? Are we conducting perception of industries towards our graduates? Are we conducting technology? What are they using by industry? These all things, all sort of study comes to research and development. But in Tibet Institute, if you sometimes, you know, people are afraid with research and development. Research and development report means in this case, we are not seeking like 200 pages, 500 pages thesis report. Maybe one page is action research. Maybe you can trial, maybe you can research on pig in your animal husbandry farm. So that will be a like 2-3 pages report. You know, there are many things. So one page is to, you know, one line to 100 pages, but don't worry about the volume of reports, but we have to do some action research related to Tibet. Then only we can manage demand-based and programs, and for that we need a strong industry institute linkage. These are the some pictures, so it is a self-explanatory, no need to explain. And recently our team conducted in Mongolia the first pictures, and that institute got gold. Congratulations to Mongolian team, and that institute is really good one. I also visited that institute. Similarly, Malaysia, Thailand, all the institute got gold, and even in Philippines now. That's why I told you, you know, APAC accreditation is a continual quality improvement initiatives, because in the beginning there were only bronze and silver award in Philippines, but now those institutions already got gold. Five already got gold means they have done a lot of improvement. And now the national body like TESDA, Technical Education Authority of the Philippines, that is a ministry, they have make a mandatory APAC accreditation. They have a star rating, internal accreditation. Now they have make a almost mandatory for APAC also. That is an external evaluation. Similarly, Malaysia, Philippines is doing it. And even in India, there is one Nachimuthu Polytechnic in Tamil Nadu, in the South India. That institution is a very good institution in South Asia. If you have time, in the South Asian country can visit that institute. It will be a great knowledge. So these are the some pictures. So, and I already mentioned about there was an association. There is an association of AAA. This is the information about AAA. The specific objective of AAA is to facilitate regional mobility through staff and student exchange, to expand learning opportunities, to ease sharing of learning resources, to improve quality of the delivery of Tibet programs, and to strengthen operations of Tibet institution to realize the full benefits of APAC accreditations. These are the key objectives, specific objectives of the AAA. And the meetings of the next meeting of AAA is happening in coming December in that Nachimuthu Polytechnic, Tamil Nadu, India. That is in Nachimuthu, that is near the border of Kerala and Tamil Nadu. You might have heard about Madurai. So that is near to Madurai. So these are the things. So AAA meeting will happen in India. And at present, the chairperson of AAA is principal of the executive director of that institute, Indian Institute. Okay, so APAC, whatever the criteria, like 7 criteria we talked, we are evaluating those criteria based on PDCA model. So in every criteria, we'll see, if you go to this APAC manual, accreditation manual and guideline, you will find the sub-criteria. There are many sub-criteria, I'll explain little. Most of them manual and are guideline. Based on PDCA plan. Has organization developed plan or not? Have they implemented according to plan or not? Have they conducted check part means monitoring and evaluations, and how they are doing feedback management. So every criteria will be evaluated based on PDCA model. That's why APAC main tools is PDCA model. So this is the things. And now I'll talk about the criterion one. So governance and management, I'll talk a little bit because time is already 1 hour, even though this is very important. Criteria one, governance and management. In this institute, this institution system of governance, and we will see the governance and management, how they are responding, how they are managing the organizations, how is the board of that institute, and how is their, you know, like operation systems, and how they respond for change management. So under this, their indicator one is decision making and management system. How is the decision making system there? Participatory or autocratic? And within that indicator, there are six sub-indicators that in bracket, in parenthesis, SI means sub-indicator. So in that first indicator, there are six sub-indicators. For detail, please visit our website. And there is that detail. Somebody is making noise, please. And indicator two, program and budgeting. Under this indicator, there are five sub-indicators. Criterion two, teaching and learning. So the institution has a clear defined mission and as an academic, technical, vocational, these all program we'll see there. And under this criteria, there are six indicators. First one is strategic link of learning objectives. Like I showed before, is that institute learning objectives is related to national educational objectives or not? Is there a link or not? For example, our national objectives tells poverty alleviations through TVET. Or let's say enhance employment through TVET. Or our national objective is more focus on self-employment. So are we conducting self-employment focus program or not? Means strategic link. Then second is curriculum. Under curriculum, there are four sub-indicators. Third is instructional guide. Under teaching and learning materials, fourth. Under that, there are three sub-indicators. Indicator five is teaching methods and techniques. Indicator six is monitoring and evaluation management. Under that, there are two sub-indicators. That's why criterion two is teaching learning resources, teaching learning environment. We will assess that criteria. Criteria three, human resources. You know, human resource means there will be two types of human resource. Teaching staff and non-teaching staff. So indicator one is qualification of teaching staff. Under that, there is a two sub-indicator. So qualification of teaching staff will take the reference of the national government minimum requirement. So APAC will not bring our own qualifications. We will follow the respective countries like public service commissions or TVET authorities qualifications requirement from the job description of that position, okay? So qualification of non-teaching staff and teaching staff assignment and workload, there are two sub-criteria, sub-indicator, and indicator four is system of recruitment, evaluation, development, and motivation. So how is the recruitment system of the human resource? Is it transparent or not? Or like a principal recruit whoever they like, or all he have recruited all relatives, means they will get zero mark here. So are they following the national standard or not? Recruitment process. So these are the things we'll see in the human resource part. And criterion four, research and development. Under this research and development, program of research and development. So do we have a research and development program in our operational plan or strategic plan or not? We'll see that part in institute level. Teaching staff engagement in R&D. Are teaching staff engaging in the research and development or not? That is a kind of learning. That is a kind of development for teacher, you know. If teachers involved in research and development, this is a part of lifelong learning. They will understand the labor market. They will understand the industry's environment. So that's why R&D is very important for teacher. And indicator three is dissemination and utilization of R&D outputs. Like I told PDCA, you know. Like first, if you see, research and development things, programs, you know, all. And are these outputs, research and development report, are we utilizing or not? Are we disseminating or not? For example, institute conducted research or TVET authority, and are we applying that research report to revise our curricula or not? Are we applying that research report to train our human resource or not? Are we applying that research report to change our technology within our classrooms and labs or not? So these are the things we'll see. An indicator for management of research and development. It has four sub-criteria, sub-indicator. How we are managing that, or how is the management system of research and development, okay? Criteria five, image and sustainability. In this criteria, we'll see, like image of the, we discussed already, you know, the image of the institute is one of the, you know, if the stakeholders perceive very good, very positively, that is a good image. So outreach program, are they conducting outreach program or not? Institute are conducting outreach program or not? Like there are under this indicator one, there are five sub indicator. Income generating programs, that IGPs, is there income generating program or not? And linkages and networking, that is very vital. Industry institute linkage, what is the linkage and network initiatives of the institute? We'll see basically three indicators and nine sub-indicators within three indicators. And criteria six is other resources. Other than in human resource, all the resources comes under this. That's why financial resources, it has six sub-indicator, and physical facilities, it has four sub-indicator. Library, it has six sub-indicator. Tools and equipment, two sub-indicator. Information and communication technology, four sub-indicator. Repair and maintenance management, two sub-indicators, okay? So this is a very important criteria, other resources. So our team will assess very properly to all relevant resources based on the minimum requirement. How is the situation there? And number seven, support to students, because this is a very vital, like a guidance and career counseling. How is the guiding and career counseling system within the institute? And what is the student services? What are the different services to the students, like cafeteria, e-sports, cultural program, outing, many other things, you know? And like alumni, students' alumni office, network, post graduation things. So all comes under this. So these are the seven criteria and indicators and sub indicators. So for details, you can visit our website and you will find that you will find the all the guidelines and criteria from that website, and you can read it. Okay, now I will show one video about OPAC.
APEC accreditation is an internationally recognized sign of quality. It evaluates institutions based on the following seven criteria. Governance and management.
We have improved a lot in various aspects thanks to APEC. We have received six grants for products developed by the staff from the Public Private Research Network, also known as PPRN. And this project aims to help small and medium industries in Malaysia.
The quality assurance system, which is the backbone of the school's operation, was put in place.
Teaching and learning.
It can enhance the teaching and learning methods and strategies such as collaborative classroom, flipped learning, and blended learning in providing holistic and balanced students.
Human resources measures adequacy of faculty members and staff qualifications, experiences, and development.
Having this APAC award provides us opportunities for staff development.
Research and development.
A APEC certification that was awarded to us in 2015 helped us to gain the trust we needed from the private companies, and that they will have confidence for us to conduct research in manufacturing custom machines for their products.
image and sustainability, provision of expertise through community services, consultancy and income generation, and linkages and networking.
Because the APEC is an international institution accreditation, it has helped prepare us from other international accreditation. I believe that the accreditation will affirm our standing as a leading TVET institution in the region because we obtained the gold award and the highest score. We have since received benchmarking visit from not only from Malaysia but also from countries in the region.
It shed light on the areas for improvement, which signified more focus for our organization, specifically on research and development and image and sustainability.
Other resources measures the adequacy of financial resources, physical facilities, library, and information technology.
These recognitions help us to become more aware and responsive to any issues related to the facilities and resources.
Support to students required for holistic student development.
There is increase of almost 10% of our graduate enrollment from 2015 to 2016. Proof that APEC exercise help us to identify the best strategies in promoting our graduates.
APEC accreditation is the most significant recognition to PKP, which support us to be better today and in the future.
Going through the APEC accreditation process need a lot of hard work, commitment and cooperation. But in the end, it is all worth it.
Go, go, go for quality assurance through APEC accreditation.
Okay, thank you for your attention. And this is our contact, Asia Pacific Accreditation and Certification Commission, Colombo Plain Staff College. And telephone number, email, and website is in the right corner, top right corner of these slides. So if you have any queries, you can send by mail or you can send the message. And thank you very much for your patience and very long wait. So once again, thank you. So there are some questions yes, in our quality management systems, even in APEC, there is inside, if you go to our details, you know, guidelines and APEC accreditation manual, the greening TVET also there, that is a sustainable, how that institute applied sustainable education system, sustainable TVET or greening TVET, definitely that part is considered. And for how to re-accreditate APEC, just re-accreditate also same process you can apply. After 4 years completions, so the one-time accreditations will remain just for 4 years, but within 4 years, institute has to submit in every 2 years, they have to submit the biennial report. We'll see that report and we'll award certificate. So after 4 years, you have to come to again, the accreditation process, re-accreditation process. If in re-accreditation, there are some fee waived. So no need to pay for like a registration fee. And there are some others incentive as well. And so I already mentioned that. So TVET institution to be directly without government permission. So can TVET institute to be an APEC accredited directly? Yes, you can. You can apply, but like private institute, they can apply, but public also they can. But in public systems, normally, you know, with deal with international organizations, it will be better to come with like a national level authority, that NCA, national, you know, coordination agency, like things very important. Like a Tibet, if polytechnics comes through Department of Technical Education, if polytechnics comes with the, you know, the ministry, that will be better. But if you come, if you feel okay, no need to come with them, even though OPAC will do that. But normally public institutions come through the national authority. And there is a question, how can we strengthen quality management system in teaching learning process? I already mentioned, to strengthen quality management system, first you have to introduce quality management system in your organizations, like teaching learning means in teaching learning process also, you have to develop plan. What is your teaching learning development plan? Based on your plan, you have to recruit right persons. And you have to provide adequate tools and equipment in your classroom. And you have to develop different pedagogy and andragogy and different, you know, the diversifications of the methods, training delivery methods, course delivery methods. You have to develop the learning environment based on your curricula, like cognitive part, psychomotor part, and attitude part. How do you deliver those components? So quality management system means plan, do, check, act. There's, you have to introduce all sort of, so you can strengthen. If you start your activity in your institutions from planning, implementing those plans, evaluating those activities, then based on evaluations report, improve for further, improve for next. Means this is called quality management system process. So you can do that. For that, we need very committed leadership. If teacher want to improve, instructor want to improve quality management things in the classroom and labs and workshops, but if principal doesn't support him, it will not happen. That's why leadership commitment is the vital. Leadership commitment is the vital. Leadership commitment is number one things for the quality management system and its enhance. So leadership is vital, okay? Then another question is, what are the challenges in implementing QMS in educational system? Definitely there are common challenges. Main challenge is resource. If you are thinking to quality management system and OPAC accreditations, you need resource. You have to, resource means like you need qualified workforce. For example, according to your government minimum standard, one polytechnic should have 20 instructors to conduct two diploma programs, minimum standard says 20 instructor. But if you are implementing two programs with 7 instructors, definitely you will get low marks. That's why resources, you need resources. The difficult challenge is resource, not only financial resource, human resource, financial resource, time also resource. Like a principal, instructors, management, top management, everybody has to give more time for the quality management system. If you start, but following years, you know, if it comes into the system, you need less time. First, you have to develop system. With, as I already mentioned, you know, if there is no subsystem of system, that is not a system. So to be a successful polytechnic institute, you should have subsystems here, like teaching learning systems, bathroom system, hotel system, cafeteria system, security system, greening period system, gardening systems. There are many subsystems, okay? So resource, time, commitment, that is the challenges for you. And you need full support from the stakeholders to implement quality management systems. And that is, you know, if we able to implement quality management system, that is a beauty for your career also. So quality management system is for you, for your leadership, for the quality outputs, graduates, for the institutional image, for the institutional emails as a whole, Tibet authorities image, and ultimately the image of the country. If the polytechnic or Tibet graduates of particular country, for example, Bangladesh, Nepal, Malaysia, Philippines, if they go to other countries, for example, Middle East or Gulf countries, And did all the employers send, you know, thank you letter saying your graduates are excellent. They are very obedient. They are intelligent. They are smart. They are above than our expectations. Means that is your pride. That is country's pride. And they will recruit only that particular country's workforce, not from other countries. So that's why quality management system is for you, not for OPAC. That's why I think that way. This is a marketing tools. You please think your institution is a company, is a private sector, is an enterprise. Then this OPAC accreditation is your marketing tools. As a public employee, as a government salaried employee, you have to think your institute is your own enterprise. Then only you can bring quality management system. But if you think my institute is department institute, my institute is Ministry of Education institute, I'm just a servant, means you will not bring quality management system. Wherever we are working today, we have to give 100% effort to that institute, then we can bring quality management system. Hope you got that answer. So any specific input creating, developing staff discipline among operational team, system development? Yeah, definitely for staff motivation, you know, you have to, like I mentioned here, in human resource criteria, you have to recruit right persons. You have to provide right job description for them. You have to train. You have to provide training and exposure opportunity them. You have to provide additional responsibility to the best performing staff. And you have to maintain, means we can maintain human resource. Maintain human resource means how to motivate them. Like we have to reward them. We have to recognize them. You have to conduct picnic, retreat. You can conduct every month yoga program within your institute. You can go outing. You can recognize them in front of public in every graduation day, like an annual anniversary day. You can recognize best staff, best instructor, best security guard, like best student, like that way. Then you can manage, you can implement, you can maintain them. More, sir, can you explain more about ecosystem of QMS? Yeah. Quality management, QMS, ecosystem, three P's means people, programs, and things, you know. That three P's and four C's, if you are talking about quality management system, you cannot forget those seven elements. Customer is the center. Always, whatever we do in our institute, ultimately, our single activity should satisfied, will focus to the customer satisfaction, means our graduate satisfaction and employer satisfaction and our financing agency's satisfaction. There are different type of customer, you know. Direct customers are graduates, students, and employer. And indirect customers are parents. And our government also indirect customer because they are financing. And other development agencies who are financing to our institute, they are also customer. That's why to satisfy them is our core job. And there should be a commitment and communication. We have to maintain communication with them. We have to do, as mentioned, leader has to demonstrate commitment, communications, cooperation. So that's why the whole seven elements, if that whole seven elements works together, that is called ecosystem, like a global, like natural ecosystem. Tibet ecosystem is that 7 points, three P's and four C's. Okay. So I think how much financial impact on institute? Definitely financial impact is, you know, I already mentioned that's upon you. If you are smart and if you are able to sell the OPAC accreditation certificate to your donor agencies or your stakeholders or industries, how smart you are, then definitely you will get more resources. If you are not smart, even though if you have 10 certificates, it will not work. That's why leadership is smartness. So smart leadership, smart classroom, smart system, smart environment. You know, there is a one saying, you know, I want to sell for to get financial resources. There is a one saying, if you want to evaluate a person, you have to see the dinner plate of that person, how that person is eating that food. He or she, are they throwing the making wastage of the food? We can evaluate their planning, because if you make a waste, means you are very poor in planning, because you ask more food. So if your dinner plate is very clean, means that is you are a smart eater. Similarly, in organization, signboard and reception, front desk will indicate how smart is that organization. And similarly, of the country's smartness, you can see the traffic system of that country. If you landed to a particular country and if you see very good traffic system, means you can imagine that country has a quality management system. If the traffic system is worst, nothing will happen. That is a kind of indicator one, but it might not be apply everywhere. That is my perception. I might be wrong, but these are the indicative things to evaluate person, evaluate organization, evaluate country. That's why quality management system, if you have quality management system and if you have a certification like from Asia Pacific Accreditation Authority commissions, definitely you can use that certificate to bring more resources. Then I can give you example. Now in TESDA, here in Philippines, TESDA is providing additional budget to the institute who are getting gold award, more budget for gold award, additional than their regular budget, okay? And second, for the silver, they have developed such policy already from government. So OPAC accreditation and certification becoming the financial resources, you know, pooling tools. So you can use that. You can also do, like in Bangladesh, like in India, you can use this, because you are one of the policy makers. Tomorrow you will be the DG. If you are director today, you will be DG. So you can introduce this policy. Hope most of the answers covered. If not, please send us by email, then send us in our, then many, many things you can get answered from our website. There is OPAC manual, there is OPAC guidelines, there are many things. Please visit our website. If you are not clear, we will answer you by email. Thank you very much. Namaste. And once again, thank you for your patience. Thank you for my team. Thank you all CPSC staff and participants and respected TVET professionals around the globe. Once again, happy Ramadan Mubarak. Despite
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
Mr.
Thank you, sir.
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 Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.